Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Are we blessed?
Yes.
Are we blessed?
Yes, we are.
Are we grateful?
Amen.
Are we happy?
Yes.
Are we joyous?
Yes.
So throughout this month, we've been learning on understanding, and particularly for the Thursday midweek service, we've been learning on methods of developing understanding. Hallelujah. So the first week we were taught by Brother Dickens that the one way we could develop our understanding is by reading. Hallelujah. The one thing that stood out for me in that sermon was the sitting posture when you are reading. For some of us, we read while in bed. For some of us, we read while our backs are sloping on the seat. Hallelujah. And one thing that made me take note of this is because I'm a victim of this. Hallelujah. I'm a victim of this. For me, this it was a point of correction that I'm not supposed to be sitting. Thank you for that powerful word. And last week we were taught by Mommy on observation as a method of developing understanding. If you did have a chance to listen to that word, kindly just review it. Just go back and listen. If you listened and you did not come out with something, then I urge you to kindly go and listen to it again. It was a power-packed word. By the grace of God, it was a blessing to me. It was an eye-opener in so many ways. By the grace of God. Hallelujah. And as we conclude this midweek series, this week, we're going to be learning on thinking as a method of developing understanding. Hallelujah. Thinking as a method of developing understanding. So our anchor scripture for this particular theme of the month has been Proverbs chapter 9 verse 6. Proverbs chapter 9 verse 6. I know Daddy has mentioned this scripture through our Sunday services through and through. But I'd like to bring to our attention something that I noted today. Of all the days that we've been reading this scripture, there's something I noted today. The book of Proverbs chapter 9 verse 6. I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, "Forsake the foolish and live, and go in the way of understanding." Hallelujah. So in reference to what I'll be teaching today, it's dawned on me that the people that we so call foolish are people who do not think. Hallelujah. If someone ever mentions that you're foolish, it means that you did not, because this particular person did not think on this particular matter. It's not that they do not have the capacity. It's not that their mind is not developed. It's only that they did not give it a thought. Hallelujah. And it proceeds to say, the same verse 6, it says, go in the way of understanding. Go. If my English serves me right, if someone tells you to go, it means you're moving. You're moving in a particular direction. You're moving forward. So it means understanding is not backward. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Understanding takes a forward trajectory. Understanding takes a forward movement. So as we go through this series today, what is thinking? What is thinking? And before I start, I'd like to engage us a bit. I'd like to engage us in a thinking task. I'd like to call it a riddle. So, there's a building with 10 floors, okay? A building has 10 floors. So there's this man, he lives on the 10th floor. So every time he has to go down to work or to go for shopping, he uses the elevator. He moves from the 10th floor to the ground floor and does what he does, goes about his business. And when he comes back, he uses the elevator, but he doesn't go to the 10th floor. goes to the seventh floor. Any of us here who can give me an answer to that one? Why does it go to the seventh? Yeah. A building has 10 floors. Yeah. So a man lives in the 10th floor. So every time he has to go out, he has to go out of that building. He uses an elevator. This elevator goes to the ground floor. And he goes about his business, comes back and uses the same elevator, but only this time he doesn't go to the 10th floor, he always goes to the 7th floor. Why does this man go to the 7th floor? Yes or no?
The elevator is 7th
floor. No, but he was coming with the same elevator from the 10th floor. So the elevator doesn't reach the 7th floor, it goes up to the 10th floor.
You mean the elevator?
Sorry?
He
didn't press where he was going, yes. That could be an answer. Anybody else? Yes, or no?
Exercise.
No, he doesn't exercise. So what am I doing? Like, in this moment, you're all thinking. You're all searching for a solution. Okay? You're all searching for a solution. The answer is, this man doesn't go to the 10th floor because he suffers from lower physique. He can't reach the button that presses the 10th floor. So what he reaches the 7th floor, okay? So when he goes to the 7th floor, he has to take the stairs to go to the 10th floor. Praise God. So why am I telling us this? The first thing I'm trying to do is to show you that whenever you come upon a task, whenever you come upon a problem, if I may use the word, the first thing that comes to your mind is to think. Oftentimes we think before we gain understanding on what we are supposed to be doing. But what does it mean? What does it mean to think? We're always just told that think outside the box. Outside the box. I believe we're all thinking outside the box. Oliver said he's exercising. He said the elevator reaches the 7th floor. And it's a clear depiction that you can only answer what you understand. Hallelujah. You can only understand, you can only think on what you understand. So what is thinking? I define thinking as a conviction. A conviction that resides as an entity whose power can only be exercised and seen when triggered to give results. I'll repeat that. I redefine thinking as a conviction that resides as an entity whose power can only be exercised and seen when triggered to give results. So the first thing, it's a conviction. The moment someone asks you a question, it's a trigger. It prompts you to like think, like, why have I been asked this? The first thing someone may ask you, what's your name? If a stranger asks you, what's your name? I don't think you'll just rush to give them your name. You first of all think, like, why does this person want to know my name? Is it true? So the first thing is, it's a conviction. So thinking comes from a place of conviction that resides as an entity. I'm calling it an entity because the thought process is an individual matter, subject matter, if I may use the word. It's an individual subject matter. In this sense, if I ask you a question, before you make reference, you are thinking, like the way I asked your question. You did not like raise your hand immediately ask the question. You are first thinking. So it's an entity. It means that it's a process of its own that goes through your mind by the time you are starting to figure out a solution. And again, I mentioned it's an entity whose power can only be exercised and seen when triggered to give results. The reason why we say someone is smart, someone is genius, is because we can see what they think. Hallelujah. We can see the results of their thought process. We can see what they mean, what they have to show for the various challenges that they have, for the various challenges that are set before them. I'll take an example of a math test. Giving my example, growing up I wasn't good in math. Okay? I wasn't this brilliant guy, but on the other hand, my brother was a genius, because there's no question he ever gave him that he couldn't, you know, give me an answer to. So there's this particular day, I remember I got home, I totally forgot that I had an assignment. So in the morning, my mom would, my mom knew I was this guy who would always not finish the assignment. So in the morning, she would always check my books, and going through the math book that day, I knew I would be caned before I go to school. And when I go to school again, it would be another problem with the teacher. So I told him, hey, I have these questions, there are 20 questions. I told him, if you do these questions for me, then I'll give you my break today. So he was first hesitant, and I was like, hey, mom is coming, you know, like you have that pressure. Mom is coming, just do them, I'll give you my break. So he waited up until mom called. So by the time I went to mom, I was trying to buy time, because I knew I had not done the assignment. So I was told, go and bring your books. I brought all the books except one book, Patrick's book. So I took to her, and she would sort them according to subjects. So she placed them, and she was like, no, there's one book is missing here. Why is it? Go and bring it. So I went and took the book, and that time I was sweating. My heart was really beating. So I took it and gave mom the book. I knew I had not done the questions. So when she opened the book, she put it on the left side. It was like, okay, what just happened? So what happened was, by the time I was speaking to mom, by the time I'd taken the other four books, my brother had done the assignment. In the 10 minutes that he had done the 20 questions. And I didn't know. So I went and looked at my book that day. It was marked, and got 20 out of 20. Teacher wondered, okay, you've never scored this much. So by the time you're going through the work, she calls me up and tells me, hey, maybe show us this. Okay, I'm in trouble, okay? So, why am I sharing this with us? You see, when it comes to thinking, I did not have the results for the problems that I had, because I did not look at the questions. In my mind, I was so fixated and so convinced that I cannot do this sum, you know. And for him, it took a few minutes. He looked at the questions, put in all the answers, and again, I find myself in another predicament where I'm being asked to teach the same things that I've scored, and I'm unable to, because I didn't even know what the questions were. I did not look at the questions. Praise God.
Yeah.
The book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 26. This is where we get to see the first instance of thought as taught by God. The book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 6, it says, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. Hallelujah. So we get to see that by the time God says that let us create man, he initiated the thought process, saying, let us make man. And how are we going to make man? According to our image. So God had the understanding that for me to create this man is supposed to look like this. So there is the understanding bit. So how am I supposed to develop my understanding? This is the first example I give. God in his grace and in his superiority and his power, we get to see that God is a thinker. Hallelujah. God is a thinker. He's a thinker, and because of the thought process that he has initiated, he gets to understand. We get to see that he saw the end before the beginning. He saw the end at the beginning. Sorry. He saw the end at the beginning. When you're trying to create something, you have an image of what you're creating. You have an idea of what you're creating. Hallelujah. You have an idea of what you're creating. So thinking is the first step to building. It is more of the beginning of execution than the conclusion. I'll explain. Thinking starts by, or rather, understanding does not start when you start doing something. It starts when you envision the end of something. Hallelujah. Your thinking starts, or rather, your thinking comes into play the moment you've envisioned the end of something, not the beginning of it. Oftentimes, we've started businesses, we did not know how to start it, but we knew this is what I want. Hallelujah. For those of us who've been part of the ministry, those of us who've had Daddy speak, and I remember some time back also when we mentioned this, for those of us that are single, those of us that were single at that time, you're told to write down a list of the qualities you want. Hallelujah. The qualities that you want. You do not know how this person looks like. It's not like when you meet this person, you know they have character A, B, C, D. You have to spend time with them to know that this is what they have. Is it true? So, it's not that I understand this is the person. I know these are the characteristics that I want. But I have to start by knowing what I want. Hallelujah. I was laughing some time back when my cousin was, I was talking to my cousin and he was telling me like, every other time he has, okay, he's funny. Think of him. I find him funny. Every other time he speaks to a girl, he says that they always tell me to wait, I'm thinking. So he asked me, what do these people think about? What do they think about? It's a question. What do they think about? Like every other time you meet a lady or you've approached a lady, for those of us who approach ladies, you've been told that, they've told you, okay, let me think about it. Why do they tell you, let me think about it? The gents are nodding. Okay, they're waiting for the answer. No, as in your thought, what do you think? Why do they tell you, give me time? Are they trying to play hard to get? Okay, let me go back to the men. By the time you decided that I want to make a move on this girl, what crosses your mind? You've thought about it, right? So you've seen like, in your mind, you've seen like, okay, if I settle down with person A, this is how our future will look like. And I'm told it's so common with ladies that by the time they fall in love, they've seen like the wedding, the family, you know, they've gone through the whole process and you're still here and I'm like, okay, I've not asked you out, we're just friends yet. And then you find this is someone, at that particular time, someone is getting heartbroken. They're getting heartbroken because they did not understand the process of how it gets there. Hallelujah. So thinking as an element, as an entity, it puts you in a place where you see the end while you are at the beginning. So the creation of man followed through a process, and God said that by the time he was saying that let us make man in our own image and likeness, God had an idea. God understood that this is what I'm supposed to be making. And we're told after that, after God saying that let's make man in our image and likeness, it was not until then. No, he said that and then went and made. Hallelujah. So understanding puts you in a position where you know. You are in the know of what you're supposed to be doing or what you're supposed to be building. Take note, I'm saying, of the what you're supposed to be doing. It's not the how. Okay? Now, what is the power of thinking? Or why is thinking important to gain understanding? Why is thinking important to gain understanding? The first thing, thought gives the power of action or demoralization. Thought gives the power of action or demoralization. So by the time you've given something a thought, you have the power to make a decision. Hallelujah. Back to the example I've just given about the ladies. There are those that have been told no. There are those that have been told yes. Why? It comes about by what you understand. Okay? You ask someone, like, why didn't you just being this person, they're like, I just don't see myself in them. And someone may say that's a vague answer, but it's true. You see, understanding gives you a vision. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Understanding gives you a vision. And it brings us back to the book of Proverbs chapter 9, verse 6, the second part where it says, go in the way of understanding. So the moment someone makes a decision, they make a decision to move in the direction of understanding. Hallelujah. You make a decision to move in the direction that you understand. We choose careers based on what we understand, what we know we can do. Praise God. There's a reason some of us are not engineers, the reason that some of us are not doctors, because we do not see ourselves in this capacity. But there's a reason some of us are accountants, some of us are practicing the various fields that we are practicing, because by the time we were starting to study, we had identified points A, B, C, D as how our lives would be. Hallelujah. And it gives you a roadmap. So thinking, again, gives you a roadmap towards where you're supposed to be or where you're heading to. Remember, he's saying, thinking does not answer the how first. It answers the where. Where am I supposed to be? What do I want? Once you've identified the where and the what, that is when you get the power to find out the how of where we're supposed to be going. The book of Numbers, chapter 13, verses 33. Can you open with me? Let's open our scriptures. The book of Numbers, chapter 13, verses 33. Am I making sense? Numbers, chapter 13, verses 33. If you're there, you can shout at the giving, amen.
Amen.
And it reads, and there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which came of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. Hallelujah. So I want us to take a note of two words which have been said twice. We were in our own sight. Not gain vision of what could be possible, you've not gained understanding on how you are supposed to be doing these things, you've not gained understanding on what you're supposed to be doing. Hallelujah. But you get to see a different thing. By the time Joshua and Caleb gave their report, they had a different perspective of themselves. Hallelujah. They had a different perspective of themselves. And truth be told, we oftentimes find ourselves in this situation where we're like, that task, no, I can't do it. You know, I know. The answer to it, if I go, it's all, you know. And it's something that we usually make so subconsciously that it becomes a norm, it becomes part of our system. And we often transfer this to generations, and you find a child. Ask them, like, what do you want to be? Do you want to be a doctor? They say, no, that is too difficult. You told them that was difficult. They must have had it from someone. Hallelujah. Because this child does not know what it takes to be a doctor. But they know it is difficult. How do they know it's difficult? They had a conversation. One thing I've noted with the kids is that kids learn so much from what they hear than from what they read or what they see. Like if a parent tells a child, a good example is the IG session you're having last week. By the time your father tells you, like, I love you and I know you can do it, there's that motivation that grows in you. Is it true? But by the time you're told you're always lazy, there's nothing good that comes out of you. find that these children battle issues of self-esteem. And that is the position that we've put ourselves in. It's not that someone has pushed us to fight issues of self-esteem, but because we do not have a vision, we do not have an understanding of what we want, we end up being demoralized. The book of Proverbs, chapter 23, verse 7, it says, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you." Hallelujah. So we are a product of what is in our heart. We are a product of the understanding. You cannot execute what you do not understand. You cannot manifest what is not within you. You cannot manifest what you do not know. For example, someone tells you, okay, I call Dickens, kindly find my pen. Kindly find my pen, sir. What's your question? How? You see, like, he's asking how, because he doesn't understand what he's looking for. Hallelujah. He's asking how because he doesn't understand what he's looking for. But by the time you trigger the thinking process, it will be like, okay, I'm supposed to be looking for a pen. So the first thing I know, if I'm looking for a pen, it's not that seat. It's not that stool. I'll rule out everything that is not. Am I making sense? I'll rule out everything that is not. So I remain with the options that I think, okay, this looks like a pen. There's the blue pen, there's the white pen, there's the red pen. Which among these pens belong to him? So the thinking process puts you in a place where you have the power to make the decision. You have the power to move forward. As shown in the book of Joshua chapter 14, verses 11 to 12. Can you open it in Joshua chapter 14? Joshua chapter 14, verses 11 to 12. Anyway, it reads, "As yet I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war, both for going out and for coming in." Verse 12. "Now therefore, give me this mountain of which the Lord spoke in that day. For you heard in that day how the Anakim were there, and the cities were great and fortified. It may be that the Lord will be with me, and I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said." Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. So the three things I want us to note here. The first thing, Joshua is depicting confidence because why? He knows what God said. Hallelujah. He knows what God said. And when I started, I said, understanding shows you the what and the. The what and the what. The what and the where. Understanding shows you the what and the where. That is the ending point of where you're supposed to be. So Joshua was convinced that this is what the Lord has said. This is where we are supposed to be. And how was he supposed to go about it? Again, you see, he says that, "I am as strong, just as my strength was then, now is my strength for war." He knew the how. The how to get to where God had said was the war. Hallelujah. The war aspect was how Joshua was supposed to get to what God said. And it proceeds to say from verse 12, "Now therefore, give me this mountain," the confidence this man has. How many of us can stand today and say, "God, give me this mountain"? How many? We can say, I pray, they can cast out demons, they can raise the sick, they can heal, they can pray for the sick to be healed. But when you get the task at hand, how many of us can really execute it? Hallelujah. It takes a different form of understanding for you to know that this is what I can do and this is what I cannot do. Look at the story of Job. I was talking to someone this weekend who was making fun that, do you know by then if God hadn't pointed, if God didn't point out to Job that the the Satan would not have tempted Job. Because the devil only wanted Job after God mentioned, if you read that conversation in the book of Job chapter 1, Job was up and about the earth, but God brought in Job, the subject of Job. He said, have you considered my servant Job? It means the devil did not bring Job to the picture. It's God who brought Job to the picture. And you're making fun and you're saying at times, God, God puts you in a place and you're like, okay, God, what did I do to deserve this? But God knows that you have the capacity. You know, God knows. God is fully convinced that I know you. He says, I know you by name. Praise God. God knows you by name. So God puts Job in this place, and Job was just there looking at his sheep, you know, looking at his cow, and he said, those number of cows are going to give birth like this particular time. And then all of a sudden, God gives up a drama and Shaitan. But Job understood one thing. One thing that was so profound is that Job understood that it's not about what he had that sustained him. Hallelujah. To a point that the wife told him, why don't you just curse God and die? Job did not do that because he understood that it's not about what happens to me that determines who I am. It's about who is with me. Hallelujah. It's about who is with me. What does his word say? By the time his friends came forth to speak to him, the one thing that Job told them is that I learned was that Job stood steadfast, knowing that even if all these things have been taken from me, I still have God. You know? And the moment I still have this factor God, if the moment I still have this power of God, all this can be regenerated again. And if you continue to read, you're told that Job did not work for what he had. By the time he was healed, people came in and gave, and he had double of what he had. Hallelujah. Job did not have to go and tell the land to build his wealth back. God brought it through people. So it brings us to the point of, again, understanding. Like, the moment you think, if Job would have said, okay, God, I curse you, you know. But Job gave a response, saying, will you praise God when you receive good and fail to praise Him when evil is on us? Hallelujah. Because this is something that he had thought about. He knew that, okay, I was in a better place, but now, despite the fact that things have changed, I'm still able to get to that place because I have God. Hallelujah. But again, we look at the other spies that were sent. They say that in their sight, they were like grasshoppers, and as such, they already lost the battle. And we get to see again Joshua, from Joshua chapter 14, verses 11. We get to see that Joshua shows boldness because he understands. He understands what God is saying. You know, he understands. The only thinking that he's bringing in is that, how am I supposed to get to where God is saying? So, that is the first point. As we go forward, thought gives the power for action and demoralization. So again, what is the power of thinking? Point number two. Thinking brings or gives understanding for creativity. Hallelujah. Thinking brings or gives understanding for creativity. Thinking provides a platform for creativity, which gives unlimited power to what we can achieve and what we can do. Hallelujah. The moment you say, for example, I use the field of IT. The moment someone builds a system and they understand it and they know it, there's no way, there's nothing you ever do to lock this person out of what they've created. Am I making sense? Because this person, by the time he was creating this particular system, he knows all the entry points, all the weak points, and all the strong points that this particular system has. So by the time I'm building something, by the time I'm building something that I have thought of, if I present it to you, and to tell me, no, you can't do it like this, I'll have all the answers to explain why I should do it like this. Because it is my creativity. It's something that I've thought about. Hallelujah. If you take these books, for example, we cannot go to the author and tell them, you did not, this is not how it was supposed to be, because it's not our thought. It's not our conviction. It's not our creation. It is the creation of the authors of the book. And that's why we read them. We read the books to gain understanding on how these people came about these ideas, how these people came about what they have. I've never, okay, maybe there is, but I've never come across someone who's challenged someone about a book they wrote. Just a quick question. Thinking about it. When you're in school, primary, no, actually high school, you'd be asked a question like, what do you think the author meant? For example, in poetry, what do you think the author meant? And then you write your thinking and the teacher gives you a wrong one. It's my thinking. Is it true? It's my thinking. It's my thinking, yes, but that work is not my creation. Am I making sense? It's my thinking, but the work itself is not my creation. So the creator of this work gave a roadmap, gave a blueprint on what this particular script meant. And the very fact that I've given my thought about it doesn't guarantee that, yes, it's my thought, but it doesn't guarantee that it is right in context of what was written. Hallelujah. The book of Genesis, chapter 11, verses 4 to 6. Genesis chapter 11, verses 4 to 6. Grace of God. I read it says, and they say, come, let us build ourselves a city, and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. Verse 5. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And verse 6. And the Lord said, indeed the people are one, and they all have one language. And this is what they begin to do. Now, nothing they purpose to do will be withheld from them. Hallelujah. So, these people came about with this idea. We get to see that God, who is the creator of everything, says, these people, nothing will stop them. And if you read the starting part of this particular verse, this particular text, the people say, spoke among themselves and say, come, let us build this. So it was their thinking. This is their creation. So you get to see that when the time you initiate thinking, it gives you understanding for creativity, which is almost limitless. Like, what you can achieve is almost limitless. If you read this verse further, we get to see that God confused them. God made them speak different languages, and at that particular time, the building came to a halt. Up to the point where they had built it, by the time God came down. So it means that if these people, if God had not brought about confusion, then these people today would have like a building that goes to heaven. Hallelujah. If, for example, nothing happened to it, maybe we would be having a building that has gone up to heaven. But what is my point exactly? Thinking gives you the creativity, and this is how powerful your creativity is. So in whatever we are doing, in whatever tasks we have, the assignments that we have, the various inventions that we have today came about as a product of thought. Someone gave it a thought. Someone sat down and envisioned and said, if I build this aeroplane like this, then you should be able to carry this number of people. You know, and they sat down to put in the work that was involved to come about with this product. The same thing we see in this text. These people thought and said, okay, let's do it. And the moment they started building this tower, it took an external force for them to be brought to a standstill by the grace of God. As we wind up today, how do I build my thinking to understand? How do I build my thinking to understand? The book of 2 Timothy, chapter 2, verses 15, it's a common scripture within this ministry. And it says, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So how do I build my understanding? Feed your mind, the spirit, with information. Hallelujah. You cannot be creative beyond what you know. There's a point of, okay, let me use this example. You cannot think about what you don't know. Is it true? And how do you gain what you don't know? By acquiring information, by acquiring knowledge about it. That is what the book of 2 Timothy 2:15 speaks about. It says, be diligent to present yourself. Again, by the time you're getting this information, there is the diligent part. And then, rightly dividing the word of truth. So it means you can wrongly divide the word of truth. Some of us get frustrated. We say that, okay, I have this information. My example, It's not that I did not know the mathematical formulas by the time I was presenting the assignment to my brother, but I did not know how to rightly apply these, these formulas. So it means there's a, by the time you're gaining information, you need to like do it right. There's information, you need to be selective on the kind of information you're ingesting. Hallelujah. You need to be selective the type of information you're ingesting. Again, how do you build understanding? Or how do I build my thinking to understand? Serve to a cause or to a purpose. Hallelujah. Serve to a cause or to a purpose. You cannot think beyond what, okay, you cannot think on something that you do not know you're creating. For example, I would take clay or plasticine. For me to create something out of that, I need to know what I'm making. Is it true? So it means the cost of what I'm making. For example, I want to make a car. I would build a car from this clay or from this plasticine. So my purpose is to create this particular object. That thing you get to see. Keep and surround yourselves with people that are going or have arrived to where you are going. The book of Psalms, chapter 68, verses 11. How do you build your thinking? Keep and surround yourself with people that are going or have arrived to where you are going. Oftentimes, say things like, if you find one rich man walking with five poor people, the man is poor. You say, yeah, that's our creation. This is where it comes from. The Lord gave the word. Great was the company of those that published it. Company. Company is a group of people. Praise God. So these people were great. He took the same classification of people, the same people with the same intentions, people with the same agenda, for them to be great. Hallelujah. I'll just read that again. The book of Psalms 68, verses 11. The Lord gave the word. So you get to see God gave the word. And then, great was the company of those that published it. So God gave a word and there are people who published it. But before they published it, in between from the giving of the word to the time the word was published, these people were great. Hallelujah. So if my kind of people are the people that will always murmur, the people who will always riot at instructions, the people that will always object to ideas that are supposed to be benefiting me, then I'll be in the same mind frame as them. I'll be in the same classification, despite the potential that I have. Hallelujah. So, your potential is only as good as the company you keep. Your potential is only as good as the company you keep. So, if the people that I'm working with, our agenda is to own bicycles, then we'll have plenty of bicycles. If that the people I'm working with, the agenda is to come from a bicycle to a car to a jet to a yacht, then I'll be prompted to move towards this direction. I'll be thinking on how am I supposed to go through this to get to that particular place, the company that you keep. Proverbs chapter 29 verses 3 is still on the same point. Whosoever loveth wisdom, rejoice. Rejoice his father, but he that keepeth company with harlots spendeth his substance. Hallelujah. So spending our substance does not only mean monetary value. We can spend our substance in terms of the time, the resources we have. Yeah, we've all come across people say that, see what this person has amounted to, and he was a bright person. It's because of such circumstances that this person did not understand where he was supposed to be going. He or she surrounded themselves with these people that limited where they were going. And finally, how we develop thinking for understanding is meditation. The book of Psalms, chapter 119, verses 99. Psalms 119, verses 99. It says, I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies and my meditation. Hallelujah. So it's possible to have understanding beyond what your teacher teaches you, but it comes from a place of meditation. Meditation is a guarantee for understanding. I'd say that again. Meditation is a guarantee for understanding. It's a guarantee. The Bible tells us that, you see, if I go by what I've been taught, then I'll only understand it up to where I've been taught. But if I introduce the meditation part, then the scripture assures us, this is an assurance, that my understanding shall be more than my teacher. Praise God. So, as we leave this place today, as we conclude on the subject of understanding, I believe by God's grace we shall be different people moving forward. We shall have a different mentality. We shall have a different speed of doing things. We shall have different company in what, in where we are heading, rather. Having said this, let's take it beyond our feet. And let us make a prayer. Praise God. Let us make prayer. In the past 4 weeks, we've had 8 sessions that we've been taught on understanding this particular man. 8 sessions. These are the Sunday services and evening services. Let us just take grace that as we've spoken about these things, let it not just be a topic that you went through. Let this not just be another, hey, it was a great sermon, you know. I was so blessed, what do you have to show for it? If the word blessed you, what do you have to show for it? Hallelujah. So I want us just to pray a word over every person that has been listening to this series, the Sunday services, the midweek service, as we've been taught to read, to write, to observe, and now to think. As we implement these things, as we raise our voices before the King of Kings, that our understanding shall not be the same. We shall be distinctive. We shall be distinctive among our peers. Father, in the name of Jesus, we say thank you. We take grace to our Lord, that for all that we've learned, King of Kings, all that we've been taught, Jehovah Father, we ask for grace to practice these things, put them into action in our lives for the transformation of our lives, Jehovah Lord, that our lives, our lifestyle shall be a testimony. We shall be episodes to be read by those that are around us. Those that meet us, King of Kings, will desire to know you by the lifestyle that we live because of our understanding, Jehovah Lord. We pray for them that have been listening to this series, King of Kings, by the grace and the power that is working in the life of your servant, Abraham. Father, we pray that you may give us understanding for a generational impact, for a life-transforming impact, Jehovah Lord. That as we present ourselves before you, Lord, this series shall not be in vain, King of Kings. We shall understand to redeem our time. We shall understand to multiply the resources we have. We shall understand, Lord, when to speak and when to keep silent. We shall understand, Lord, when to go about different things in our life. All for the glory and honor of your name. Receive all the praise, receive all the glory, receive all the honor. We bless your name and we give you all the praise. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we give you thanks.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we give you thanks.
Amen.
And let just put on emphasis on this last point about meditation. There is so much in what has been taught this month. Sunday services, the midweek services. Let us not be fool of ourselves that it was taught and already had it. Praise God. We get to a point of meditation. A point of meditation means, for those of us who may not understand what meditation is reflecting and thinking on a particular subject. Reflecting and thinking on a particular subject to unveil the mystery that is behind it. Hallelujah. So, for everything that has been taught, the observation, the writing, the thinking, and all the topics that you've learned from Thursday service, can you just go back and meditate on this entire subject of understanding? Hallelujah. By the time you gain understanding, then you'll be at a very powerful point to execute the things you're supposed to be executing.